I want to thank Heather for inviting me to be here today, and to all of you, thanks for coming out on a, you know, I guess for you a normal day, for me it'd be kind of a cloudy, rainy day, and to come and hear about mixed methods. As Heather said, I'm working on a second edition of the book, and so one of the chapters that I'll be adding is on mixed methods. So you are my test audience to see whether I'm like totally off base, whether I'm talking any kind of sense at all. So I'll be inviting you to participate in this conversation. Okay. I'm going to be running back and forth because I don't like to stand still. Here's Creswell's definition of mixed methods. Mixed methods research is, quote, an approach in which the investigator gathers both quantitative, closed-ended, and qualitative, open-ended data, integrates the two, and then draws interpretations based on the combined strengths of both sets of data. So let's break down this definition just a bit. Two types of data, quantitative and qualitative. I mean, that's kind of the buzz around mixed methods research, I think. Some people have described themselves as qualitative researchers. Some people have described themselves as quantitative researchers. And in mixed methods, the idea is both. You will use both and somehow put them together. We're going to talk more about that in just a minute. The other part is that you integrate and interpret based on the combined strengths of the two types of methods. So each of the two types of methods has some strengths and some weaknesses. And the idea for designing a mixed method study is to try to offset the weaknesses of one with the strengths of the other, and vice versa. So that's part of your rationale for trying to combine them. So we're going to spend this hour talking about the types of data involved and their roles in a research design and the reasons for using mixed methods, and we're going to look at a couple of examples pretty closely. If you looked at my book, you know that I'm big on examples, so I've chosen a couple of mixed methods examples, and we're going to look at those. Most of us divide up the research world in various ways, one of which is this, related to the type of data that we're working with. And what we mean by quantitative data is that all the variables are measured and numbers are assigned to them. Okay, so let's keep it straightforward. They will be numbers. Okay. Qualitative, usually what we have in qualitative data is narrative or visual descriptions of some phenomenon of interest. There may be numbers involved, but not usually. Usually the numbers, if they are involved, aren't of concern particularly. Now, note that this is a little bit different. My really straightforward, simple definitions are a little bit different than what Creswell said in his definition of mixed methods research, which is one of my quibbles with his definition. So let me just say what I mean by that. He equates closed-ended and quantitative and open-ended and qualitative. But I would argue that you can have closed-ended qualitative data in the sense that you could ask a categorical kind of data question like, which school do you attend? Okay, you're only going to get one. I mean, it's qualitative because it's not, you can't really put a number on that. I mean, you could, but it wouldn't mean a number. You can also have open-ended quantitative, like how old are you? It is somewhat constrained. I have seen people give survey responses to something like that that weren't constrained, but normally you would be expecting a number back. But it can be almost any number. There's lots of different numbers you could have. So we have qualitative and quantitative, and for our discussion today, what I want to do is keep with the simpler definitions. Just assume that qualitative data really is qualitative in the sense that no numbers will be assigned in any numerically meaningful way, and quantitative where we will be dealing with numbers when we're dealing with quantitative data. So the advantage of this kind of distinction of how do you divide up the world is that it's nice and simple. If you can see the data, you can tell what it is. That's about all you have to know. But the disadvantage is that you don't really know much about the data itself in terms of how you can analyze and get meaning out of it. Yeah, it's numbers, but what can you know from that? I mean, just because it's numbers doesn't mean that you know whether you're going to try to do correlations with it or you don't know what you're going to do next based on it just being quantitative. Or based on it just being qualitative, you don't know necessarily how your analysis process is going to unfold. Just because it's qualitative, it doesn't tell you very much. Okay, so this is where I want you to jump into this conversation. Who has done some work with quantitative data? Okay, so give me, somebody brave, tell me what kind of data you had. Okay, yeah, there's a whole bunch of people. Did you have some?
Reaction time data.
Okay, so reaction time, things like that. What else?
Movement
in what way? How far they moved? How fast they moved? Just how far? Okay. Okay. Okay, so rating scales and numbers from those. How about qualitative data? Who's worked with qualitative data? A few fewer maybe, but not quite a few. Okay, so what kinds of data? Interviews. Okay, so we have interviews and the words that come out of those interviews recorded in some way. Other things besides interviews? Okay, with open-ended questions. Open-end questions on surveys. Okay, so you have text from tweets, existing data that were created for some other purpose besides your research, and now you're grabbing that data and working with it. Ethnographic field notes, you've watched some things and you describe those as you've been out there. Others? Say that?
Photo elicitation.
So you have photos that you're using then in some way to either inspire additional text being created or in other ways you could code them directly in some way. Okay, so there's lots of different kinds of qualitative data, lots of different kinds of quantitative data. Now I'm going to suggest to you a different way to divide up your research world. Okay, so you may divide up your research world by your epistemology. And so we need to break that down because normally I don't use four-syllable words, but it's more than four. It's a lot more than four. So what we mean by epistemology is how we gain knowledge. How do we gain knowledge? The dictionary definition of it is the study or theory of the nature and grounds of knowledge, especially with reference to its limits and validity. It addresses a question, on what basis can we claim to know something? On what basis do we say, I know this? I make this claim that I know it. And this is really, again, way, way, way oversimplified, just like qualitative and quantitative was. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of shades of here, and there's also different perspectives not represented. I understand that. So, but we're going to just keep to these two for now. The first is positivism, or logical positivism. This grew out of a general empirical approach, the process of directly observing, recording, or monitoring the social or natural world. The impulse is to see things directly that are occurring in the world, things that are happening out here. We're trying to do the evidence we would say use to say that we know something is that we have observed it. We have somehow measured its occurrence in the world. Creswell defines it as a means for testing objective theories by examining the relationship among variables. Whenever anybody starts talking about objectivity as a good thing and variables as a normal, you can pretty much say they're probably coming from a positivist view, because those are the kind of standard language you would use to describe your work. In a positivist view, quantitative data is really highly valued, because it assumes that that perspective assumes that all variables can be measured if we know enough about them. So the only time you would really want to use qualitative data is on your way to knowing enough about a variable so you can measure it with numbers. You can assign numbers to it. Objectivity is valued. Subjectivity is equated with bias, at least most of the time, in a positivist view. So you're trying to get rid of any subjectivity. You're trying to be objective. You're trying to measure things that you can directly observe. Okay, on the other side, we have interpretive research. It's a means for exploring and understanding the meaning individuals or groups ascribe to a social or human problem. The key thing here is meaning. It focuses on socially constructed meanings. The idea is that for anything that us as social scientists want to know about, those things, all of those constructs are socially constructed. They are not something that you can, in some ways, objectively observe, because there isn't really any objective anything. It really is all about intersubjectivity and understanding us coming to agreement about what's happening in a particular setting. So it involves contextualization, taking into account the environment and its effects. It involves understanding the range of what we can learn from observation. It involves pluralism in the sense that you need to use a lot of different methods to fully understand a phenomenon that is occurring. And it involves expression. The results are usually expressed as stories or rich descriptions of what you've found. This division of the world has its problems also, yes, that's true. But it does tell us more about what to expect next after you have some data. It tells you a little bit about what's going to happen during the analysis phase that just knowing whether it's quantitative or qualitative doesn't really tell you. So in a positivist research study, you would most likely be using statistical techniques to analyze your data so that you can draw conclusions that can be generalized across a population. You may use qualitative data in a positivist study. That's not really a problem except that it's considered weaker because you don't really understand the variable well enough to measure it yet, but you're on that path. If you're an interpretive researcher or conducting an interpretive research study, you'll use a lot of different approaches. You'll analyze data that you've gathered from a lot of different sources, and the goal is to understand the multiple meanings of the phenomenon held by the people participating in that phenomenon. You would assume that you can find out something that is true, in some sense, within that setting, but it's a shared understanding as opposed to an objective single thing. Okay, so I would say that the difference between these two perspectives causes problems for us when we come to mixed methods research studies. Trying to combine qualitative and quantitative data may mean that what you're trying to do is combine an interpretive and a positivist epistemological stance in the same study, which this is where I stumble when it comes to mixed methods research. I find that really hard. I can't figure out how to do that. Now, Creswell and Plano Clark in their textbook argue that pragmatism is our philosophical approach that's going to resolve this conflict. And because it values both subjectivity and objectivity, it allows us to abandon such metaphysical concepts as truth and reality by focusing on what works. They haven't quite convinced me, but I don't know yet a lot enough about pragmatism to be sure that there isn't something there. So if you know a lot about pragmatism as a philosophy and can come and talk to me after this, I would really appreciate it because I want to figure that out before I finish writing up the chapter for the book. Okay, so now, before I asked you who's done some qualitative work and who's done some quantitative work, so who has done some positivist, and I want to say, I should make it really clear, I was discussing this morning with one of our doctoral students, it's like, so do you have to do all of one or all of the other? I said, no. In any, you know, over a series of studies, it seems really likely that you'll use some of each. But it's just hard for me to figure out how to do them in one study. Okay, so how many people have done at least one positivist study? What kind of research questions were asked?
How do you use demonstrations to learn?
Okay, so use demonstrations to learn, whether they're effective for learning?
Yeah.
Yeah? Carol?
Who did you talk to about who did you talk to about?
Okay. Okay. So sources of social support? So very closed in. Okay. Other examples? Does anybody do experiments? Yeah, I know some of you guys do experiments. So almost all experiments are pretty much positivist in their stance. How about interpretive studies? What kind of study? What were you looking at?
Ethnography.
Ethnography? And what was the phenomenon of interest?
Understanding of a group of 6 to 10 years who were trying to review values of social justice in technology concepts.
Okay. Okay, so you can see just in that question, you can see how you're really looking at multiple people's perspectives on what might be the values you're going to try to imbue in technology as you design it. It doesn't help you to have some kind of homogenized view of what those system engineers think. It only helps you to know what each of them thinks because that's what's going to get acted out as they do the design. Okay, so let's go on then. Even though I have stumbling blocks with using mixed methods, I think you should use them. most often when you're using mixed methods, the reason is because a single data type won't fully address your research question or won't fully help you understand the phenomenon of interest. So, like I said earlier, the two types of data offset each other's weaknesses. You can use qualitative data to further explain initial results from a quantitative study. You can use quantitative data to be able to generalize results from an initial qualitative study. So there's some ways that you can combine them sequentially that really make a lot of sense and can really be useful. You can combine those in the same study report. So in a particular document, you could be reporting on kind of a phase one, phase two kind of sequential mixed method study. And we're going to look at some examples. Example one. And you should, and this is where I need to thank my grad assistant, Sarah Beth Nelson, because she's been on the lookout all semester. She's been looking in the literature to try to find good examples of mixed method studies. So this is one. I think this is a pretty good example. It was published in College and Research Libraries in 2008. The purpose of the study was to better understand the mechanism relating critical thinking and library anxiety. So the idea was that people whose critical thinking skills are not quite so up to par also might be anxious about using the library. Okay, so Quan had 137 undergraduate students who were taking an information literacy course, you know, kind of your normal captive audience, and used quantitative measures first. So they took the California Critical Thinking Disposition Inventory, a normal validated measure kind of thing, and then the group was divided into the high scores and the low scores on that scale. Then they took the library anxiety scale, and basically the comparison was made between the high group and the low group on critical thinking to see how their anxiety scale scores were. And it confirmed that there was a negative relationship between the two variables. The next thing Quan did was to try to figure out what was going on a little bit more. So some qualitative data were also collected. The students each wrote one essay about their most recent or most memorable experience of using the library, including their thoughts and feelings about that incident. So kind of a soft critical incident technique approach to relating a personal incident. They did it in writing rather than interviews, so there was no opportunity for follow-up or anything like that, but it was some possibility there. The content of those essays was then analyzed to figure out about this relationship, whether she could see any relationship between the two variables there. So let's try to break this down in this study and think about it as an example of mixed methods approach. When you're thinking about designing a mixed method study, there's two critical questions you need to address. The first is, how or when will the two types of data be collected? And the second is, how and when will the two types of data be integrated and analyzed? Each of those is fairly distinct. You could collect together and analyze separately, or, you know, different kinds of combinations. In this particular study, the data were collected together, right? Students filled out the questionnaires, they wrote their essay, they were out of there, one session. But then the two types of data were analyzed separately. And in sequence. So first, the quantitative data were analyzed to confirm that relationship between the two variables. And then second, the qualitative data were analyzed in order to understand the mechanism underlying that relationship. Okay, so what do you think about this? Is this a good example of mixed methods research? Do you see any problems with it? Questions about it? Carol?
Did they pick only the qualitative answers from the? Did they pick the subset to look at, or did they look at it?
I believe they looked at everything. They didn't say that they didn't. They looked at it after they knew, I assume that for each essay they knew what their score was on each of those two scales. So they knew whether they were higher low critical thinker and higher low anxiety level. Is it a problem? What do you think?
Yes, I do think it's a problem.
See, your positive streak is showing here. Okay, so in what way is it a problem? Okay, so preconceptions could be coming in from your own bias, based on what you know about the scores.
Second,
It didn't say, you know, I have to be honest, it didn't say in the article the order in which they analyzed the data. So they could have analyzed the qualitative data first or without knowing the scores of that individual on there. I don't know for sure. Okay, but see, you just said objectively, so that's, you know, that's why I say your positive streak is coming out.
Well, I'm going to ask you something else. I've heard from others, and this is probably a good example, that if you take your quantitative survey, and then you decide to cherry pick certain people for your qualitative interview, that is a really bad way to mix methods, because because what happens is people then say they've got an explanation for the general behavior.
Oh, that's the bad part. I mean, up until then, it wasn't necessarily bad, because it could be that you're trying to choose, you're really only using your quantitative data to do a purposive sampling. And so you want to know characteristics of the people, and then you're going to choose ones that fit your purposive sampling plan. That would make sense. But then you're really only oriented toward that subset as generalizing your results, right? It's only when you try to then say something about the whole group from which you drew that's a problem.
Yeah.
Other thoughts about this study? Yeah, Lauren?
Well, without knowing too much about the coding, it sounds like a better example than many I've seen.
I try to pick good examples for the book.
I mean, at least they did seem to, in the quantitative part, they did seem to try to really
They do have valid measurements that are much higher quality than our normal kind of LIS study.
Hypotheses in this kind of study.
Yes.
And then in the second part, they haven't just done what's often happening is they just look at the interviews. Kind of, there's this thing where they just sort of say, and it seems from the interview that these were the things going on.
Yeah. Yeah, it doesn't describe their analysis method for the interviews very well, so you can't tell how deep they went. If you're really taking an interpretive stance, you're going to be working with those interviews in a lot of depth, or in this case, essays. You know, the students, it didn't say how long the essays were. I'm picturing a paragraph. That would be what I would expect to get from a student if I was doing this kind of study. So you don't have a huge amount of data, but even so, if you do intensive coding and stuff where you're really doing line by line or word by word, you probably got a much richer understanding of what's going on in there than if you just like read each essay and said, oh yeah, that says this.
A big challenge here, I think, is to describe the methods for each part in as much detail as actually required. And I think you often don't get that in this method.
You don't get that in qualitative in general. The nice, easy part about quantitative research is that we have all shorthand for all the things that we do. So you can say, you know, I did this particular statistical test with these assumptions and blah, 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 and you got it, one sentence, and you've got it. Whereas that's much, we don't have those kind of shortcuts yet for most qualitative methods. Yeah. Did you have another comment about this?
So I don't think that the application of a quantitative collection of data is very well designed, because what if the relationship had been different, or there had been no relationship, would you still be using the same?
I don't know. It does make you wonder. Like, would she? I mean, you would still want that data, I think.
It seems to assume that you can do everything you want with quantitative data.
I think there was like one previous study cited to make you expect that it was going to come out this way with the quantitative results, but that's not a lot to go on. It could have come out where there was no effect, then it probably wouldn't have been published, or possibly flipped, you know, where the people who had strong critical thinking skills were the ones who were anxious about going to the library. It seems unlikely that would have happened, but possible. I mean, so that could have been problematic. If that had happened, though, you still have the essays, and you would expect that the essays would tell you about why you got that result. I mean, that's the main thing. It's like, if you either way, whichever way you got, it's like, so why? What's going on? The mechanism of action is really what they're after. Yeah. So what do you think? Should I put this one in the book? Maybe. It's still got possibilities. Let's talk now just briefly about kind of a textbook view of research design in mixed methods, and as we go back over this. Creswell now has a new edition of his mixed methods book. So if you're doing mixed methods, I'm sure you've already seen it. It's out in 2015, though, so it's brand new. He has several different research design in there. I would consider three of those to be really primary, and so we're going to just work through those today. So the first one is convergent design. Here you have the quantitative and the qualitative data being collected in parallel. They may be simultaneous, like same session, same participants, or they may be separate. It may be different sessions, possibly different participants. But the idea is they're happening kind of in parallel in some sense. Then the two or more data sets are merged in some way prior to interpretation. You're really bringing the two data sets together in some way. They may be compared to each other. They may be related to each other in some other way. But they're coming together before you do your interpretation. So what do you think? Is this the design that the quant study fits? Would you describe the quant study this way? Okay, I see a bunch of... Okay, so you're... I would say that it happens in the compare or relate and merge spot bowl. And interpret is like, then you're drawing your conclusion, yeah. Mm-hmm. In what way are they together?
A personality inventory and a test result. Those are two quantitative data collections.
Yes. And the way that should show up back here, you should have two quantitative boxes. And they get then merged. Because there you have two data points, basically, for each person. Yeah. Does that make sense? Okay. So, well, I'm asking whether we think that this design is the one that the quant study used, or would be. That's how you would describe. No, quan, K-W-O-N, the one we just looked at, sorry. So I saw a bunch of, like, no's. Okay, so I would say yes in the data that are merged for the final interpretation, but no because the quantitative data were analyzed first and the qualitative data were analyzed next. Okay, so the next type is explanatory sequential design. This is one of the two sequential ones. In this one, you have quantitative data collected and analyzed first. Then the qualitative data are collected and analyzed to explain the quantitative results. And then you draw final conclusions based on kind of that sequential merging of the two. So what do you think? Is this the quant study? You don't think so? Why not? Yes, you're right about that. But the analysis phase came after. So I think this is actually as close as we're going to get to what happened in the quant study. You know, again, the textbook examples are kind of idealized. They're all very clean and neat. It looks like it all happens in a nice sequence. When we do real studies, it doesn't get quite so neat. But I think that this is probably where the quant study would fit. In the sense that we had the quantitative data first, the two scales, their correlation, and then we had a result from that that then is we're trying to explain it with the essays and what we analyzed from them. Okay, let's look at the third one. It's called exploratory sequential design, and I have to tell you, I wish I hadn't named these. I mean, they're right, but I get them confused because they start the same way. So exploratory. In this design, the goal is often to develop a measurement instrument. So if you've done some psychometric work, I assume that's the way you did the engagement scale. You start qualitative and then you go to quantitative. So you have some exploratory qualitative data collection, and you would normally position it as exploratory because you're just starting into an area. You're trying to get your first understanding of it. That will help you then develop an initial design of an instrument or possibly an intervention. Creswell's book talks a lot about intervention studies also, which aren't so big in ILS, but they are in like public health and some other social sciences. And then the next phases would more use the quantitative methods. There might be multiple phases of testing and purifying an instrument. pilot testing and intervention, evaluating its success. So in this way, the quantitative phase builds on the earlier qualitative phase. So this clearly does not apply to the quant study that we just looked at. But you can see it occasionally in ILS literature, particularly in development of a measurement instrument. So that's where you might see it most often. Yeah?
In the quant study, just specifically from the essays, they might have had anything in those essays to do with critical analysis, critical thought. And so, but they might have found something else in there, and not that I'm being cynical, but they might have collected a number of different measures, just decided to sort of present the.
It's possible. It's possible.
Maybe it relates more to something else.
Yeah, I haven't done like a thorough literature search on the author to see whether there's like other studies that all the data were collected at that same session, and they just oh yeah, this one works, so we're going to publish this one. I don't know.
But it could have led to the next stage, which might have nothing to do with
the thinking. True. I mean, you could have done them because they were collected at the same time. You could have flipped them. So if you did that, let me think about this. So, yeah, I mean, you could have done all of the essay and described that, but then you'd have to wait to decide which measures you're going to do until probably a second phase with those students, probably a second occasion.
Question, kind of related to your interpretive versus positivist, and I like that point, but it seems these kind of studies, like quant study, is really so aiming for positive outcome, even if they've mixed in some methods that look somewhat interpretive. So I'm thinking of the difference between their kind of work, which still tries to come to an answer, versus something like action research, which is coming to something to implement, to test again.
Uh-huh. Yeah, you know, I think it's always interesting. Oh, repeat the question. Okay, so, okay, I wasn't paying that close attention. Let's see. The question was, could it have been done? Let's start it again.
Okay, so. It seems to me that the quant study is aiming for a positivist.
Right, right. Okay, so if quant really, okay, so sometimes it's really fun to think about what stance a researcher is taking in a particular study, because hardly anybody ever actually just says it, right? Okay, so what kind of cues? So the question here is, was quant really taking a positivist stance with this study? And even though qualitative methods were incorporated as to interpret the quantitative results, really the main focus was on the quantitative results, and that's we're expecting that there is an objective relationship between the library anxiety and the critical thinking skills. My reading of the quant study is yes, I would guess that quant was taking a positivist perspective. There's nothing in there that looks deeply interpretive. In how the methods get described, the level of detail in the results, there is a lot of rich description of these critical incidents of library experiences and things like that, where if a person was in interpretive research or doing an interpretive study, I would expect a lot more of that. I haven't so far, let's go to our second example, because this one is much more explicitly. The researchers are taking a much more explicitly interpretive stance. So Rebecca Wilson, who's one of Lisa Given's students, did a study looking at the effects of spelling challenges when you're trying to search an OPAC. Okay, so there can be spelling challenges, meaning you don't know how to spell the word you're trying to search on. So the experimental design was for the quantitative data. Yeah. They have 38 college students. The 38 college students are randomly assigned to one of the two treatments, either hard spelling tests or easy spelling tasks. And the query terms then, the person comes in and the query terms are read aloud to them. And they're to search on that term in the OPAC and find particular types of information about that. So I think it was like life cycle of lemmings and life cycle of ptarmigans. And if the person couldn't figure out what the word was that the person was saying, the researcher was saying, they would get a really short description of it, like a ptarmigan is an Arctic bird. Okay, so that was the setup for the experiment. So clearly, I mean, it's an experiment. It's a positivist kind of approach to it. The participants also completed a pre-search questionnaire about demographic characteristics and their amount of search experience. Nothing new there. But then they did a post-search interview about the reasoning behind their search behaviors, their confidence in their searching, any problems they experienced while they were searching. Okay, so, you know, again, that could have been a very surface kind of interview, you know, 5 minutes kind of thing where you ask them a couple questions and they give you answers. With these researchers, it wasn't. It was much more in-depth. I think they said anywhere from like 30 to 70 minutes or something like that for the interview part of it. It was a little bit more in-depth interviewing than you might normally expect when you're just starting out with an experiment. The behaviors that they observed were things like use of particular strategies to check spellings. And they had basically a qualitative categorization of those strategies, then followed by frequency counts of how often each person used each one. They had instances of corrections of spellings and how often those occurred. The search strategies they used and whether they tried multiple strategies or fields they searched, there was quite a few different kinds of things there. And again, they were counting them up. And then search success. Did they find some stuff that was reasonable? The qualitative data from the interviews, which were conducted after the searches were completed, and a subset of data was used in this article. There's another article which we'll talk about in just a minute that reports more of it. They were trying to, the qualitative data in this particular citation, in the JASIS article, only talk about which resources were used to check the spelling and the ways in which the searchers experienced spelling difficulties as an obstacle to their searching. Okay, so thinking about those two kinds of things, again, you can see that what they want to know is each individual's experience. It's a different kind of question than what's the overall experience? What kinds of things do people do? Which they're getting with their quantitative data, they're getting some kind of general run on how people interact. But when they start to ask these interview questions and try to think about them in the way the searcher experienced difficulties as an obstacle, that's going to be very subjective, and that's what you're interested in. You're interested in the subjectivity of it, how each person experienced it. The more complete analysis of the interview data was reported in Information Research in September of this year. It focused on the mental model of the search process that they use, the search shape, they call it, which is, it's a really interesting new look at that. They talk about searcher self-concept in relationship to searching, searcher self-efficacy, and types of searchers, which they have new categories of types of searchers based on their behaviors. So, any questions about this one? Because I'm about to ask you which of the three major designs this is. Okay, which do you think it is? The first one, the convergent design? I think so too, actually. So, the convergent design, if you remember, was that you have the two things going on kind of in parallel. And here what we have is we have quantitative measures of search behaviors and search success. We have qualitative information about resources used and spelling as an obstacle. And they're collected during the same session. The interview was conducted after the searching, but it was like right after. I mean, it was immediately after the search. And the data are juxtaposed prior to interpretation. So when you read the article, you can see it isn't like they do all the quantitative data results first, and then they talk some about qualitative, like Quan did. Instead, they talk about corrections of spellings, and then they talk about the resources that they use to figure out how to get correct spellings, so that the interview data are well interleaved with the quantitative data. I think that's most of what we want to say, but what do you have, what questions do you have about this study? Or comments about it? Yeah?
There seems to have time difference in the two techniques. I mean, you can run the quant stuff through the computer and pop your answer, but the qualitative you've got to spend more time. So how does that affect the ability to converge?
Yes, okay, so that is an issue. So the question is around the time required, because the time required for qualitative analysis is usually much longer than the time required for quantitative analysis. On that point, I tell my students, you pay now or you pay later, right? If you're doing a quantitative study, you pay now. Everything has to be designed in advance. You have to take a lot of care with your measures. Everything, you pay now. But then when you get your data, you're done. Where with qualitative work, it's like you pay later. Because it's not that hard to figure out your interview guide and get started on collecting some data. But then your analysis, you're going to pay later. It's going to take a long time for the analysis. So the question becomes then, if you want to do this convergent design, and you know, you've started collecting your data, meaning all the pay now part has been done for the quant and you're ready to know the answer, but you've still got all this weight until you know more about what you got out of your qualitative data, how do you deal with that? I think these articles are actually a really good example of what happens in normal life, which is you subset your qualitative data to answer particular kind of questions that need to go with the quantitative data, and you set aside the qualitative data, the rest of it, for other analyses and other reports. So that's one way to deal with the timing. Yeah, move in.
One of the things I wonder about here is the interviews are done afterwards, but the similar timescale issue. Were the interviews about your general information behavior and the tasks were kind of, so one is self-report and one is direct observation, direct data collection.
The quantitative data was from direct, because they had logs.
Generally, how do you search, or is
it... No, I think it was those particular searches that they did just done.
They replayed the search, or they talked about the specific searches?
I'm trying to... I know they talked about the specific searches, but I don't know whether they did a replay or anything.
Yeah.
I'd have to look back at it again.
I just think it puts a different weight of authority on the kinds of data. One is generalizing about how I review in general, and
yeah, no. They were asking... very specific, I think, about that experience that they just had. Yeah. Other comments or questions about this second example? What do you think? Should it go in the book? I think this is definitely a keeper because there's enough things to talk about it in terms of the timing and different aspects of how you might split up the qualitative and things like that that might make it a good example. Okay, so closing up here, why use mixed methods? So even though there are some epistemological challenges, I think, associated with using both kind of data in both approaches in one study, there's still a lot of good reasons to implement mixed methods. And I have to say it's been really interesting to me to watch this kind of mixed method fad come in the sense of, I guess I've always done mixed methods. I just didn't know I was supposed to call it that. So each data type, we know each data type has weaknesses. There's things that you cannot see with a particular data type, whichever data type you have. So the question is, can you put together an assemblage of data types, different data sources, that kind of thing, that actually can allow you to see what you want to see for addressing your research question or for observing a particular phenomenon of interest? We can see that from these examples that we looked at, qualitative data can be really, really useful to more fully explain quantitative results. And that can be true in both convergent and sequential explanatory designs. We can also, results from a qualitative study can be examined in terms of their generalizability with a quantitative study. So you can take results from an initial qualitative study and then build a follow-on quantitative study that may help you generalize if that's your goal. We see this most commonly in our field in development of measurement instruments, where you want something that at least as close as you can come to objective measurement of a particular variable. But there may be other instances also. In particular, I would really encourage you to think about incorporating mixed methods in a program of research. So here we've looked at two particular studies. But if you think about you're investigating something over a number of studies over a few years, then that's a real opportunity, I think, for using mixed methods because sometimes you want to look at it one way, then a question arises there, so then you have a different way you want to look at it and then another way you want to look at it. So by using a variety of methods on those, you'll get more different perspectives on the phenomenon of interest. You'll have a better understanding of it overall. that's where I will stop and let you ask any additional questions you want to ask. Free form, anything? Get ready for your question.
Any questions?
When you talk about approaching, I mean, you've got the dichotomy of the two different ways of looking at it. Yes, I can. And it seems to me that they're roughly equivalent of taking an inductive versus a deductive comparison between the two, with the qualitative being inductive and potentially the quantitative being deductive, and if you'd thought about approaching it from that direction.
Yeah, I don't know that they're that pure, though, inductive versus deductive. I mean, we normally do, well, most interpretive researchers, when they have a batch of qualitative data, do inductive coding first. But I'm not convinced that there isn't some deductive logic as they put together different results and start to theorize about some of the concepts they're seeing. I'm not sure that it's purely inductive. I mean, it is in the sense that it's coming from your data, coming from bottom up. And I'm not sure that you don't do some inductive reasoning in more positivist studies also. So you probably could split the world that way. But I think it gets more mixed up. I think it'd be harder to distinguish on a particular study what's going on.
So my question is more about expertise and skills of the researchers, because you're right, researchers, and I myself tend to identify more with
and that is a lot based on their skills.
Type of research and order, right? Yeah. And you invest so much time in learning the skills, in learning, troubleshooting, whatever you need to troubleshoot, learning the tools. And those are skills that take years to develop.
It takes a long time.
Yeah. Either with qualitative or quantitative. So for a group of people working together, I can see, that kind of division of labor. Like, okay, you do the qualitative part, I'll do the quantitative part. Do you think that that's the way to go? Or do you think that one single researcher could, for example, encompass both skills to be an efficient mixed methods researcher?
I certainly think it's possible for one person to do it, but it's not really common that one person really has that breadth of skills, I think, and temperament too. I mean, when you think about what you do with an ethnography, some people I know do not have the patience to sit out there and watch something. I mean, they couldn't do it. I mean, they just couldn't do it. And it's not the skill, it's just the temperament of being able to do that. Some people are very good interviewers naturally, so they developing that skill further is like really easy for them. Other people, it's really a struggle to hear what's going on and reacting to it and kind of think as it should go. Other people, it's like, just keep those stats away from me. I'm not going there. So you do have, I think you need to have kind of basic skills in both so that you can incorporate at least a little bit of the other when you need to, so you don't feel like you can't ask some questions because you just don't have that capability. You should be able to do a little bit, or else find a collaborator.
I'll ask a question.
Should I not have said that because you guys require both stats and qualitative research methods here?
No, okay. That's all fine. I have a question. The word triangulation gets thrown around. So what's the relationship between triangulation and mixed methods?
Triangulation is a kind of, again, fatty kind of word that I think, to me, triangulation comes mainly within the interpretive research. It's used more there. I don't think the logic of it really quite is the same as the logic that's being used here with converging results. So that in triangulation, to me, in interpretive research, is one of those ways that you can improve the trustworthiness of the study overall, trustworthiness of your conclusions by using multiple data sources, data collectors, different analysis approaches, all by using the combination, you're in a stronger position of understanding what's going on than if you use a single one. But to think about here the logic that we have of the different kinds of data coming together, it's actually hardly ever the same focus point. Usually the quantitative data is telling you something about here, and that qualitative data is telling you the sideways view or something. You know, it's like a different kind of relationship than you have in the normal qualitative interpretive kind of thing.
So if there's no, are there any further questions, or shall we end our session? Well, please join me in thanking Barbara for her talk today.
Thank you.